All right, the handout is just the remaining issues and opportunities section to look over. We've been over the other parts of it. So in the interest of saving paper, I just printed out the sections that remain to look at. If we have six different sections to look at tonight. We've got land use, natural resources, cultural resources, community facilities and services, and intergovernmental coordination. If we want to try to plow through it all and be done with the issues and opportunities tonight, we can try for that. But I don't want to rush anyone through anything. I want everyone to have their voice heard. So let's just see how it goes. But we've done some great work on this section so far. And perhaps we can wrap it up tonight. We'll see. So let's take a look, without further ado, at those land use issues and see what we think, see if there's anything else that needs to be added in. We only have seven issues under land use, so there may be more things, and there may be some obsolete things that need to go away. So let's take a look. Take a couple minutes to look at it. I should mention that I did go through it since the last workshop and
kind of refined it a little bit.
Yeah, exactly. As people requested, mm-hmm. I deleted some redundant things. I consolidated some things that seemed like they could be combined into one bullet point. I moved some things that seemed like they were in the wrong section.
Yeah.
And also, you'll see under the opportunities, someone mentioned that the paragraphs that were there before might make more sense if they were broken out into separate bullet points to make them a little more digestible, as it were. So I did that too.
Awesome. That's what I just want to double check, because I noticed little differences in the text, and I want to make sure it
right.
Looks like you went through and did some prep, some work before we got here.
Yeah, a bit of refining. So those are the differences you'll notice.
People say stricter zoning. Do they mean the enforcement of zoning, or do they mean zoning classifications that more limit land use?
That sounds like something we should reword to make more clear.
Jack, I don't know where that's coming from. I mean, I'm not sure if they're aiming for we need additional, like, there's a gap in enforcement or a gap in regulations. I wish I knew the background. That's a very general comment.
That is a general comment, and something where maybe not, I wouldn't use the word stricter because that's such a subjective word, but we saw last time at the Planning Commission that there's maybe a housing zoning classification that the county needs that's
mm-hmm.
missing because of that PD that they're trying to make on Mulligan, where maybe PD doesn't really fit because PD has to do with zoning ordinance, you know, it says that there are certain things that you have to be PD, and just cramming more houses in on lots isn't PD. There has to be something unique about it in terms of like being family focused and having playground or having mixed use so that the people that live there have a community center or a shopping that's local to them. So there maybe is something missing, but that's for a whole nother, that's a change to ULDC to add that zoning category of, a super high density that's not fitting in plan development.
I think we have to agree to disagree on some of the finer points about how the PD regs are interpreted and enforced. But what the Planning Commission got at was there seemed to be a gap between mixed-use communities and affordable housing communities. But we only have one way to get there,
right?
And that's plan development. So there was some discussion about, do you add an avenue for affordable housing or that you don't have right now? Right now we have one avenue, which is PD, for
mm-hmm.
affordable housing and really for mixed-use communities. But those are two different products.
Can't you put conditions on it when you're going for one or the other? Do you really need to do
you can. And I'm not convinced, I'm not advocating for a new one yet. That to me is where I felt like they were driving it home, was they did not seem to be satisfied with calling the affordable housing plan a true plan development.
Right. Well, and that just came up at the last planning commission meeting, where they really talked a lot about it. And in terms of enforcement, I sit on Zoning Board of Appeals, and we see almost, I would say half of the cases are because they're complaint driven, where, you know, somebody puts something that they're not supposed to, and then they have, there has to be a stop work, and then they have to come get a variance. So I don't know if it has to do with that. You know, and I understand that, you know, the building inspector can't go around and look at every single thing, because people do stuff they don't even get permit for. So he doesn't even know they should go to look at something.
If you complain, county generally responds to it.
Absolutely, they do, but there's not a way for the building inspector to go and inspect something that he doesn't know is being built because somebody's building it without permit.
Errol, I would propose that, you know, I'll try to work on some language for that PD, affordable housing, to see if there's some way we can work on that, but I just don't think we need stricter zoning an issue. I mean, unless y'all think of a comment that's like aimed at something like a problem, I kind of have a problem with putting something like that in
plan. I'm guessing that this came from the community assessment where everybody could just write in whatever they wanted?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
That was such an awesome one.
Yeah, and I don't disagree that comments aren't. I'm just saying, I don't think this is the place for a general comment.
It needs to be a specific thing. So it needs to, if we want to say, well, we want to be sensitive to the person who thinks we need stricter zoning, that we need more uniform application of zoning or something like that. I don't necessarily know that that's an issue, though, because I think we do a pretty good job.
Most of the county does an excellent job of enforcing, and I think that the zoning classifications are pretty clearly defined. I don't think I've ever had anybody bring that up to me.
Yeah. Most of the complaints we get are, you're going too far, not going far enough.
I got plenty of those.
Okay. So we'll strike that issue, need stricter zoning.
And I'll work on some language for that. I know what Gretchen is talking about. She's lifted up something the Planning Commission just did last week where they were debating how to solve a problem.
Sure.
And it may be more appropriate for the housing section.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. It relates to housing. Probably would be.
Okay. And the comment, developers look for the cheapest land rather than land that's close to existing services. What will we draft? What is that statement? What the effort in drafting would try to prevent?
My guess is that this goes back to the Dorfman report, where he talks about that the farther you sprawl out, the more it costs. And so when developers look at land that's outside the urban service area because it costs less to purchase that property, then it increases the service cost for the rest of the taxpayers. No.
I think it's about encroachment into rural areas.
Mm-hmm.
And Jack, to me it's interesting, depending on who you speak to define what's encroachment, and more importantly, what's a rural area.
Yeah,
because some areas where I might encourage growth, to some people who have lived there, think it's very rural, even though they might not realize that water and sewer was just put there.
Or has been there a long time.
And just used.
So I think
it's about that encroachment, and then it depends on, well, how do you define that? How do you define that issue?
So would you want to reword it to say something that makes it a little more clear, development is, there are a lot of different angles to look at it. What do you all think?
Well, so Jack's a developer, and I'm a rural person, so, right?
I represent a lot of developers that, and I've noticed one thing they have in common is they at least have this one issue in common, is that they buy property to sell it for a profit. And they don't necessarily look for the cheapest, they look for what they think they can pay the most money on. So if they're going to have to buy something, even if it's cheap, if it requires them to spend a lot of money on lift stations and other issues, that's an expense they include. But they might be willing to pay more for a piece of land in a certain area if they think they can sell it for more. I don't know.
I'm going to say that this is perception. Because, you know, when somebody's looking and they go, oh, well, you know, they're going to build some houses on property X, and the owner of that rural property sold it because they, you know, were just ready to cash out and not be farming anymore. And the price that they got was, they thought, a good price, and the developer thought it was an excellent price because it was, you know, rural on whatever land. I think it's perception.
It could be more an issue
stated in a positive way.
Could it kind of be like there's a disconnect between the type of development that is most profitable and the type of development that the community as a whole really needs?
Exactly.
The two examples that I see with this, and I agree with Jack, that, you know, it's one of those sentences that needs to be refined a little bit. We don't need to put the cheapest land in there because that's really not true. The cheapest land would be the outskirts of the county. They don't go for that. I mean, most developers are, you know, tuned to a point where they realize they're not going to apply for a residential subdivision out on the outskirts of the county and be successful. That doesn't mean they won't try every now and then.
They don't try.
But most of those cases are not successful. And so what you have is, I only see conflicts like that, Ariel, in two instances. One is actually just residential development. You really don't see commercial cases that often because normally commercial development needs rooftops. They want to be close to where the rooftops are. But you will see a developer test the waters with residential development in an area that may not normally because of great land prices or a deal. But I also see it candidly in schools, and not like Wiregrass or DSU because they have their central core, but some of our institutions school-wise are attracted to more rural tracts of land because of land costs and maybe just adjacent neighbors. And so that's a big factor in land use as well, is I see residential growth and school growth kind of testing the boundaries of what is urban, what is rural.
So it's not just about profit for developers, it's also about like what's affordable to or institution, organization
that's
not necessarily
right.
Making profit, like the school district.
That's right.
So it could be like a disconnect between the type of development that's most economically feasible and what the community wants, maybe.
So I'm going to try again. I want to try to make this sentence in a positive way. And I want to say that, and still this is a perception, because I know I go to a lot of meetings, I see a lot of stuff, but development should be focused on that which is close to existing services.
For urbanized areas,
So, you know, to say that in a positive way, it's an issue. We want to make sure that we do our development close to existing services so that we're already going places where water and sewer are, where there already are roads that are capable of handling the traffic. I mean, we see this problem on 41, right? We build a lot of things out there, and then we'd have a road, so we had to build a road. So if we... All right, so this is an issue, right? We're building houses that where there aren't services to handle them. So we, and it's not just developers, it's we as a community, because it's the Planning Commission, the County Commission, and the people who live in the community that don't do or don't come to say, hey, like, that's a bad idea, because we don't have the road to take care of it. So it's on all of us, not just developers, to say we need to make sure that we develop in a way that's close to existing capable services.
If you look at the second point under opportunities, this designated urban service, rural service area provide guidance for development decisions to ensure greater protection of our rural character and more efficient expansion of services. I mean, that's kind of duplication. You have it in opportunities where
it is an opportunity, but it's also an issue because we haven't always been good about it.
That's true.
We haven't always been good about it. I'm not sitting with 85 properties, houses next to me, because we were good about it. So.
Yes, the development on Corbin Road is just way out by itself. And that's what we're trying to avoid. We normally try to focus that. And most developers, they have, they honor that, and they have honored that.
How about Union Springs, the conservation subdivision that was recently developed, or rezoned right outside of AR? You're talking about lots, minimum acre, but most of them will be a little acre and a half. Yeah. They're going to be septic tanks. There's already water there, reasonably close to AR. Something like that. You say good, bad. I mean, what is it?
Well,
the road is they're not having to increase the size of the road, just given the new lots in that subdivision. Is that one that you would say is reasonably close to the services, or is that?
Well, because that's special, we tried once before to get a conservation, and they came for a variance, and then they never used it out on Skipper Bridge. So the idea of conservation, having that conservation subdivision, I think is pretty clever, actually. So it lets people have the feel of living in the country without having to have the responsibility of 5 acres, because that's what they would have to have. They'd have to have 5 acres. So I'm not objecting to that zoning district.
I'm sorry. I really just mean a residential subdivision that close to the city AR. I mean, it's not in a city, but it's close enough where developers think people are going to live there.
Well, right. And when you say there compared to Orr Road.
Right.
So Orr Road, you have to drive farther to get to something than if you are where you are on Union Road. Union Road, you're pretty close to Hayara. You know, and then that comes to that first point, that the continued separation of housing centers and activity centers leads to more traffic, you know, more time spent in your car, more time sitting at 5 points.
Jack, I think we're about to get a point with this next land use map that kind of picks up a central core of the county that connects, say, Hira and Valdosta and almost Lake Park into kind of the central development core.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the rural area outside of that. We weren't there this last, about 10 years ago. You still had a pretty big gap between Lake Hira and North Valdosta Road, but that has just grown so much that right there, right by Stone Creek, Union Springs, that area is probably going to be the last connector between like a V, between Lake Hira, Moody, Valdosta, and Lake Park. It's kind of the central core where I think development's going to be focused and encouraged.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, to me, the encroachment we're talking about is in areas that clearly I think we could all agree is it just does not, it's not appropriate. But that central V that I think this next land use map is probably going to reflect, I think is suitable for development. That's just where we are.
Well, in some places where I've lived before, they actually had what they called the preferred development corridor. You know, like, this is where we want development to be because, you know, this is where the services are. We have that to some extent here because we do have, you know, the ring that goes around the city. You know, so try to stay inside the ring because that's where the services already are. Taxpayers already paid to put them there, the services.
So is the issue really, should we just say development should be close to existing services? Is that what it boils down to, essentially, to replace the...
I'm good with that.
I mean, closest available, so I mean, I'm fine, but you could probably help improve that by saying close to urban areas rather than rural areas. Just try to, you know, sometimes we have an urban area that doesn't have services that is
mm-hmm.
appropriate, because then they extend services out there, and that's a good thing for
mm-hmm.
some areas. If we plan for services to be extended, it can be a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
before we continue on,
highway.
I hadn't participated in one of these workshops before. Could somebody just explain to me like what exactly all these issues are? And then are these opportunities down here an attempt to solve these issues? Is that how it works? Or exactly is
the
point
the,
of all this?
The issues are basically community needs. They're things that that need attention paid to, things that need to be fixed. They're community needs. The opportunities are not directly correlated one-to-one with the issues. The opportunities are good things we have, things to take advantage of. And later on in the plan and in future workshops, there's a section with policies, and that section repeats the issues and has policies under each issue. So there'll be like every single issue we've gone through, and under it will be a bullet point, one or more bullet points with policies, and those will be to address the issues. So
okay.
That's the next step after this. After this, we do the policies to address the issues.
Okay, so it's important to get the issues right because the policies will be developed.
That's right,
to address
exactly.
The issues. Okay.
And Nathan, just for historic background, these issues and opportunities, some of them came from our previous comprehensive plan.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them came from a document called the Common Community Vision, which was a big deal that we had updated here. So you're seeing things that were kind of rolled over from that.
Okay.
And now this is the first time we're really kind of debating both to see what we feel like should be carried forward or what we feel like should, you know, should stay or not.
Okay.
And in some of the other topics, we, you know, discarded some of the items and said, we already dealt with that, so we don't have to have that on our issues because they want. See you.
Right. So there won't be a policy to address that.
Right, because we already
addressed.
Yeah.
Okay.
So in the interest of moving ahead, are there any more changes to the land use issues section? Okay, let's take a look at the land use opportunities.
So the bullet point that says city opportunity zones needs some additional text to explain why that's an opportunity?
Yeah, that's one of the lines that came out of the Common Community Vision input, and we should probably make it into a full sentence.
Well, or does that, are city opportunity zones have to do with the bullet point that's three above it that has to do with infill, grayfield, and brownfield development? Are those related at all?
No.
I think they're two separate. I thought opportunity zones are based on tax incentives.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's what they really are.
So. All right. So it just needs more.
We could just say city opportunity zones provide an opportunity for revitalization of areas in need.
Yeah. I mean, to me, I thought they were aimed at providing
tax
credits.
But then it should say in there that tax credits are a part of them.
Mm-hmm. I thought their focus was probably on commercial or non-residential development to provide job tax credits for attracting jobs and trade for job tax credits. I mean, I think it's a good issue. It's just, it needs to be just built out a little bit.
Sure.
I wish we had Matt here. He probably would tell us exactly what it was, but I thought it was tax credits.
Yeah, I think that's funny. Any more thoughts on the opportunities in the land use section?
Carol, I think we put this under economic development, but I think one that needs to be in there and probably called out is our location, you know, with respect to I-75. I-75 is an asset.
Oh,
you utilize this community. And I think it's something we haven't fully realized as far as potential development around those gateways and entrances in the community, but that to me is something that's an asset. As well as our location land use wise with respect to the ports of Miami and the growing ports in Savannah, logistics wise, just seems like the Development Authority has tapped into a market there that we've been very successful in recruiting businesses that relate to logistics. So
yeah,
maybe economic development, but definitely at least I-75 needs to be called out under land use, because it's a good and I think special thing to have in our community that some communities do not have.
It is. We're fortunate to have that. I'll make sure that's, I believe that's already mostly touched upon in the economic development section, but I'll make sure all those things you said are covered. I think we have a bullet point where we mentioned connections, ports, you know, proximity to ports of Savannah, Jacksonville, and New Brunswick. But I'll make sure that also mentions 75 and major highways and the major rail lines. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think in the way that you're saying here that roads at all are being protected from incompatible land uses, so should our access to I-75 not be have incompatible land uses. We shouldn't be putting residential, for example, along places where we could be having transfer stations or the inland port.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just, I hope that one thing that will come out of this is just some kind of planning recognition for those interchanges and areas that back up to, you know, 80,000 trips a day from people inside and outside of our community. That's a huge deal.
Yeah, and around 11 and 13, those exits there where the land is ready to go for
development, yeah.
You know, of that sort, right by the airport, right by the highway, right by the railroad.
Sounds like you're advocating for recognition of transportation nexuses. Mm-hmm.
Good. Any more thoughts on the land use opportunities section? Take a look at the natural resources issues.
Yeah, we probably need something in there about, certainly insects can be an issue.
Mm-hmm.
And not only because we live in South Georgia and they can just be pests, but just because of the mosquito-borne illnesses, sometimes we seem to be more involved with than we used to be.
Yeah. Do you think that would fit under community wellness, which we have...
It could. I just think it. I think it should be in there.
One thing or the other. Yeah, definitely. Do you think there would be one bullet point about mosquitoes and other insect-borne illnesses as distinct? I mean, we're not talking termites here, right? Just.
No, I mean.
I think that. I mean, those can be a problem too, but it's just such a separate issue. I think maybe. Mosquito-borne and other insect-borne illnesses are a concern that should be addressed preventively, or something to that effect.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed that you've got issue of water quantity is one, but there's another issue about water, and that's water quality, but
Yeah.
It's very problematic.
I always thought we had an abundant, I think we have an opportunity, we have a pretty abundant water supply, in my opinion. So if I'm not water quantity is low, I just don't.
I don't see that either.
Yeah, I mean, it's like they, did they mean to say water quality?
Oh.
Maybe it was.
Because I think it's an opportunity, we have our groundwater supplies and it's an opportunity.
Well, yes and no. Yes, we have a, we sit on the aquifer, and yes, it has delicious water in it. But taking too much water out of the aquifer can make sinkholes and make people who have not so deep as they wish wells, wish they had deeper wells. And given that a lot of people in our community do have private wells, you can't drink the aquifer down too much. You might say, well, but it's a giant ocean down there. Well, it depends on where you're getting your water from out of it, though. I mean, the water at my house is delicious, but I have a deep well.
I'm a deep well, too.
And yours isn't delicious?
Oh.
It's not deep enough, then.
Well,
it's not deep enough.
Hey, Atlanta has a water quantity problem.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
The issue could
well,
be...
I think there's two issues.
But,
I think
but if they want to do
supply.
A basin transfer, like they've been trying to do in the legislature, because Atlanta has a water quantity problem, that we could end up with a water quantity problem because they, if they take the water out of the aquifer, put it in the river to send it down to Alabama and Florida where they, Atlanta wants to send it, then we end up with a problem. So we want to make sure we don't have a problem.
So there could be two separate issues. One is the water quality is not always perfect. Water quality is sometimes poor, that they're sometimes the wrong kind of bacteria in the water, etc.
It's
and
the halons that I worry me that cause cancer.
And then another issue that water quantity isn't necessarily low, but excessive draws on the aquifer can be a threat.
Could jeopardize everyone's water supply. Well, and
it's actually one of our assets around here. We have an abundance of groundwater, but it's something we need to, I think, put language in here. We want to safeguard.
Correct. You know, like I said, we're sitting on this wonderful ocean of water, but we don't want to have something bad happen to it. Now, just think of our neighbor to the east, Waycross, and their water, which they're drinking out of the same aquifer we are, but their water has something gone wrong in it, and they don't know why. And, you know, they have a big health problem over there now, and they have a...
You mean quality or quantity?
No, quality. There's something bad in the water, and a lot of people are getting sick. And they now have a health investigation through several different federal and state organizations to try to figure out what is happening in Waycross's water. And...
That could be a whole variety of things. It could be the treatment process, it could be the water distribution system.
It could be a variety of things, but there's something gone wrong. We don't want to, really need to protect our water. We've talked about this a million times. We really need to protect our water, especially since our county has the most private wells, private community wells in the state.
So would this statement of water quantity is low be better stated as water quantity needs to be protected?
I had it written down as the community's abundant groundwater sources need to be safeguarded.
Mm-hmm.
Even better.
Yes.
And then another bullet point about water quality. How would you all want to word that?
I would say that the water quality is variable. You know, here she's saying she has a deep well and her water is bad. I have a deep well and, you know, I think it's delicious. Come to town. Can't bear to drink the water, it tastes horrible. So, it's variable.
I guess when you say that water resources need to be safeguarded, I guess it kind of encompasses water.
All of it.
I guess you could reframe that statement to kind of capture water quality also.
Yeah. And you make a statement that water quality is inconsistent.
Or if there are inconsistencies in water quality throughout the community.
Yeah.
I'll say that.
Because we're not just, we're not targeting at municipalities, we're saying it's sometimes in private water systems.
And in the private community well.
Even among municipalities.
Yep.
I think it's like, I think we just get used to it. All right, would that also touch on water quality as it relates to discharge of sanitary sewage?
No.
In other words, water quality or streams. It's still under natural resources, but it's the other side of the process of the water coming out that we use for the water that we put back.
Right. Which Florida doesn't appreciate us very much for.
Well, it's valid, it just might be better on there.
It's a complicated issue. But I knew it, you know, we have TMD, there are all issues with some of our stream sediments, which we had in the past. I think they're still out there. And that's an ongoing thing, partly because of the nature of South Georgia rivers. It was just something I think that needs continued attention.
Right.
Well, and
that's not necessarily a city Valdosta issue.
No, it's just a regional water kind of issue. Flood waters serve water quality for waters.
There could be another bullet point since the ones we were talking about were more about drinking water. This could just be another bullet point. It's what you said, there are TMDL issues with some stream segments.
Right. Right.
Yes.
That's the issue. Yes. TMDL is total maximum daily load. That's where they test certain stream segments to say, is this water healthy or not? And if it's not healthy, why? It's the TMDL testing goes. Yep, that's good. Also heard an issue from an earlier section, Ariel, about, I think it's an issue, it's just marketing of our wildlife management area for Grand Bay. Just could probably use some increased marketing based on all the services that they have there, the, you know, not only the nature, but just the hunting and fishing services that are available, probably underutilized. It's a really nice asset to our community.
Other thoughts on natural resources issues?
Earlier in this section, it says that in the opportunities, the downtown urban garden is great reuse of vacant downtown parcels. Should we have in here somewhere the opportunity of a project that I'm making every effort to get off the ground, community gardens, that we have the opportunity to improve our community by promoting community gardens?
Could probably just change that wording direction to be, you know, instead of for mentioning that one project, just say the opportunity is, you know, potential for additional community gardens such as, or like, the one that was put downtown. That way you kind of encompass the concept, not just, hey, this one thing is good.
Right. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that's a natural resource usage thing, you know, where we have these lots and, you know, we're actually working with the land bank where the lots are too small to put the houses on. You don't just want to have them be feral lots. To turn our smaller land bank properties into community gardens or urban orchards.
So we can have an opportunity in that section that says something like community gardens and urban orchards would be a good reuse for stagnant parcels.
It's really just a rewrite of that second bullet from the bottom area.
In some areas we looked at what we called years ago the pocket park concept. Which I think we needed for them. Which is ideas of green space.
Right.
And some of these are probably more conducive to community gardens than others.
Right.
Like equal shade trees.
Right. And
I
think of plants as natural resources.
And an aerial, an asset to me for us under our opportunities, our climate. Our climate is something that differentiates us from North Georgia, from other parts of the nation and the world is our, I feel like it's, and there's probably a better way to say this, but our warm, wet climate, I feel like is an asset to.
Mm-hmm. Well, and being far enough inland that we don't want to have hurricane fish problems.
Yep. It should be on there somewhere.
Subtropical.
Okay. Oh, long growth season.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Have we moved on to the natural resources opportunities? Is everyone okay with that? Okay, more thoughts on the natural resources opportunities. Good.
I like this version. Can you move that?
We have a green space program, at least in the county, but the state, they reduced the funding that was available for that program to, I don't know if it was anything.
Well,
but they're recently trying to reestablish.
Yeah, we went to a workshop on that somewhere mid-state, and they were doing it every other year.
They are
doing those grants every other year.
They are currently, I don't know if it's like House Bill 693, but they're currently trying to produce legislation to fund that green space program through taxes on outdoor recreation items. And those taxes would divert toward that program. But we actually have one, it's just not active because that funding is not there.
Right. Well, so if by having this in the plan, then we could apply for grants and or funding to get it.
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, we currently have a program, but I would not consider it active.
Okay.
We're kind of in a maintenance, you know, maintaining mode, not a growing mode.
The county owns a nice plot of land off of River Chase, right next to the Withlacoochee River, and it's true, it probably floods about right now. But it might be an interesting place for, I don't know, probably some of it could be used as a park, some of it maybe as gardens.
That's one of those green space properties, John, that, you know, there's protective covenants about how you can use it, but it's a passive use. One of the issues with that is parking.
Yeah, there is a...
You know, I mean, but that's been looked at because it's a neat property out there.
Mm-hmm.
But going down to your point about the Canopy Road program, I know you and Gretchen have talked about that before. You probably should add scenic route. That's
a good plan.
You know, that,
well,
that's
there
really
used to be
the
a
same.
Scenic route.
That's
there's
right.
There's still signs for it.
There's a...
So a Canopy Road / scenic route program.
Right. Mm-hmm.
With the parks and recreation redoing Langdale Park, that's going to be a huge asset.
Oh, great. Are they going to use that road?
They
I'd love to go there, but you can't get in at the time of the flood.
I think they said the end of May, but they're redoing the hiking trails, trying to make it more secure. More picnic tables.
Well, plus we're getting the new boat ramp at Naylor in the park down there. So, you know, that's an awesome opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Which somewhere in here it was talking about development in Naylor, and that park will, you know, definitely make more people go out there.
That's going to be a good attractive.
There's public access on the Alapaha.
Uh-huh.
There it is. There's going to be a new boat ramp this county's building. I have a few suggestions in this section.
This Tree City USA, it's already the college is a tree campus. And the, what is it, Georgia Power is a tree power? what's that award? They said this is the only place where it's all three, where the only community where there's the trifecta is accomplished. Between a community, a college, and I guess it's the open space in Georgia Power's power grid lines.
So it's Tree City and Tree
Campus.
And then, well,
I don't know, that's a very wrong, that's a very incorrect term.
I thought it was like tree utility.
Something utility.
Utility.
Utility or.
I have not studied it, but I would heard that it was the only community that's all three.
And on that kind of same vein, the issue is developing some trails. Maya Trail, and the Pineham that's already there.
Well, the state's even doing that to Maya Trail.
Yeah, we're getting some grants for the issue to redo Miss Whitehead's, all of her Kameas, and then we have the other one, so it'll be on that Kamea Trail project, the most southern part.
If you want to expand on the Tree City stuff, there's, I mean, other cities are in that too. In the middle of that opportunity section, there where it says water quality, sometimes people use water treatment plantable with Fuji. That plant, the new plant will be online in a couple months. And by the time this gets adopted, it will just be 4 years.
Okay.
But that's an opportunity. Still an opportunity that we have this new plant, right?
Well, yeah, it's just, there's just, the project will be done, so we'll to do it.
So we can reword it and make it more so present tense.
Well, I mean, circle all three of these. I mean, that one, city water plant, top notch, which is, I guess, a nice compliment. And enhanced wastewater treatment, that pollution waterways. You know, even, I mean, Valdosta is not the only city, and well, that never be the only city that has sewer issues. Those filtration is not the because we've had a particular problem with it. But that's going to be an ongoing issue. So I'm wondering if there's a way to wrap that into some general language. Yeah, because I know Hayhire has issues, I'm sure everyone probably does or will. It's a matter of time, really, part of it. It's you know, a symptom of aging sewer systems. And a lot of the sewer systems are hitting the 80-year mark, and that's about when things start failing.
Right.
Things start breaking.
Yeah.
Well, for example, this weekend, they'll also have some wastewater spills. I know this because they called me. What other government, city, and county around here also had those? We don't know because they don't tell anybody.
Okay.
And related to that is one of the points I put at the bottom on that page one here is we can use an independent third-party water quality monitoring upstream and downstream of all the wastewater treatment areas. And problem area of Blood Sugar Creek. Other thoughts on natural resources opportunities? Did the agro-tourism routes 37 and 41 get in somewhere?
They might not be there. I think they got in somewhere else.
Somewhere
like,
else.
I thought they were in economic development, but
it's
yeah.
A good, make sure
it's a good double check, but I thought we put them under economic development.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
There's a new agritourism effort at the bottom. Oh, yeah. Raising Cane, Georgia Olives, Farm Days.
You just stick it in there.
Yeah, I'll make sure 37 or 41 are getting there somewhere. Yeah.
You realize Georgia 38 runs through here and not Georgia 37?
Right.
Right, but 37 is the trail.
But it's nearby. 37 is nearby. Yeah.
Well, and the trail, right. Though, like I think that the winery in Hanara is on both trails. I think it's on the 37 trail and 41 trail. I think it was too. You have to do a certain number of miles of road.
And just take a little detour down the hill.
Not far.
Okay.
More marketing is an issue in this section.
It's also
just now. Okie-Pinoke,
proximity to Okie-Pinoke.
Proximity.
Uh-huh.
people know about that, they don't particularly know about Grand Bay or Banks Lake, which are even closer.
You know, we talked about the lack
of water. We talked about that under utilized, under promoted.
Right.
Particularly with influx of new residents and even transient residents, the university or Moody, they will not heard of it, they have heard of it.
We had radio personality come on wall diving down with Apucci a couple of weeks ago. Been lived in Thalassa since 2003. Never knew that the river was as beautiful as it is. Was just taken aback. So somebody's lived here more than 10 years and is on the radio every day, you know, talking about how great it is to live here. Didn't know. So we're not doing a very good job telling people how awesome it is to live here.
Yeah.
If you'd like to read more about it.
Just happened to have these.
But that is, I mean, that's something, you know, the Little and the Withlacoochee and Lapa, we have three major sections, at least two major sections that are navigable, paddle-wise.
All of them are, yeah. Mm-hmm. And swimmable, too. You know, as long as we keep them clean, then you can swim in them, too. And one of the things was there's not places to swim. Well,
as long as the current's not going too fast.
Yeah. Sometimes the width of Uchi by our house is called the trickle. You know, you can step across it and you don't have to worry about drowning there. Now, today you wouldn't have to worry about drowning. It's almost overtopping the bridge. But it's, you know, sometimes perfectly safe. Not on the width of Uchi up here. Further down there.
Okay.
Is there any sort of welcome center or anything like that in the area about Valdosta Lowndes County?
We have one for the entire state down at Lake Park.
Yeah. They tore it down.
Yeah.
They're redoing
some local
They're redoing it.
We, yeah.
I haven't been there.
Yeah, the conference center has all of that. But at one time we had all this information about rivers and what have you, but it's time, because I worked there 20-something years ago. But as time's gone on, it all disappeared, so it needs to be emphasized again.
Well, the Valdosta Tourism Authority helped to pay for the Lapa River Water brochure, and they gave us money for the Withlacoochee River Water brochure, too. So they're actively promoting those. But the thing that we need in terms of visitor center, I said this before in a different meeting, I've just been standing on the corner at Farm Days, and somebody says, "Where's your visitor information center?" I say, "It's at the conference center, but it's closed today because it's Saturday."
And
we need
we
visitor center open on weekends.
I think that's under economic development,
yeah.
So we do
maybe a representative issue.
Yes, somebody.
I've seen, I've seen like visitor centers, like these kiosks in there, and they can like, inform visitors on the cultural resources, the natural resources in the area, and activities, restaurants, so it kind of, that could be a way of kind of like merging some of those, all of those together in one.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but you need one that's open on the weekend.
Yeah.
The museum is open from 10 to 2 for visitors. The tourism pays us to be open that day from 10 to 2. But most people don't know it.
Right. You just mentioned more restaurants.
Yeah, we send them to restaurants.
And people have very different reasons for stopping here. And one guy was in the museum, he and his wife, she was saying he's played golf for 3 days, as long as the sun was up in Florida. And he started talking and he said, "I come through Valdosta to even smoke and pig. They're from Western Pennsylvania." And he said, "I've got everybody we know headed to Florida stopping to eat the smoking pig." So I was out there one day and I told the guys, I said, "Do y'all know y'all are a tourist attraction?" So
all of it matters.
Yeah.
You know, who knows? I mean, maybe there needs to be little quick trip brochures or something that speak of that. And,
Well, there just was articles
somewhere about... That's people that from towns are just amazed that that park is in the middle of all this area that's going to be, that is already is populated and becoming more populated. The people that get it, they're interested.
It surprises them, Mr. Dahlem, when they see, you know, when people are out of town, I try to show them downtown, and I try to show them BSU, kind of at a minimum, because it surprises them, because they kind of see just a glimpse of what they see off the interstate. They don't know kind of the part of the community further to the east. You know, community like this with an Air Force base, you can't get very far on it, but it's there. And then, you know, some like Wild Adventures, it just kind of surprises them.
Those interchanges are not our best side.
No.
Okay, well, so is that,
could be better.
Cultural resources, our improvement of our energy is a cultural resource?
I think it's economic development. I think it's land use, you know, and the county, the county and city leadership has started to grab all of that, because there's more talk about gateways in the community, and they're really starting to grasp that as a shared goal, and I think that's going to be a great thing.
It was talked about a lot, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, and it sort of got quashed, and now I think it's starting to come back to life.
Just going to be good.
I was to find some grant money to put up some markers at city entrances just to start something.
The chamber has a lot of information, but you sort of have to know to go there and get it.
Sure.
All right. In the interest of moving ahead, are we finished with the natural resources opportunities?
Yes. Okay. So we're all looking at cultural resources issues now.
Okay.
Okay. I can guess who wrote this first one.
It's a good one, though.
It says next to it, Nichols House.
Oh. 100 issues, and then the last one, or something, but it's a general one that applies to just about everything. Or if there's a more general section to put in, economic development is kind of general.
Yeah, it could. There's an intergovernmental coordination section.
Yeah, it talks about. The first one, of course, has to do with historic preservation, but there's rebirth of the movement in AIRA. Consider adoption of a local historic district, something that they toyed with back in 1995 and 1996. They actually adopted an ordinance in 1996. They never appointed their board. It's interesting. I read this and all of that here 20 years later. And it's something they're wanting to work in tandem with their downtown development authority, which is also getting back off the track. Smaller communities, not just hang out, but others too, and they want to pursue it.
So smaller communities could pursue establishing historic districts.
Or just adopt strategies to protect historic resources, mm-hmm. to identify and protect. Some communities really haven't identified a whole lot.
Carol, I think something to the effect, and I'm not convinced the language is what it needs to be, but I think maybe it belongs under cultural resources, is addressing elements of racism in the community.
Mm-hmm.
One of the examples that I see is sometimes that will influence growth depending on people's attitudes towards a city school system that is predominantly black or a county school system that is predominantly white.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if we specifically mentioned the school systems in the example, but I think just maybe a statement saying there are still, in my opinion, elements of racism in the community that I think are holding the community back.
Mm-hmm.
Elements of or perception.
Yeah, I mean, and that might be more appropriate, Matt, but to me, Matt and I are, part of our job sometimes deals with that. And I'm not trying to get into anything about bidding process, hiring. I'm just strictly going from my experience in land uses that I think sometimes there are elements of racism that can be an effect that I've seen related to the school systems that we have in place.
Well,
and I don't think it's a good thing. I think it's an issue.
I think it's an issue when I would take the schools totally out of it. When I first moved here and I invited a friend to go to a place, they said, well, I can't go there. That's a white place. You're kidding me. So there is the perception that there is a division of the races in some way. I agree with that.
I think we're not being honest if we don't put it down, even if it is just a perception. I've been around it enough to be like, okay. You know, if the perception is wrong, great. Let's prove it with some numbers. Let's put something down so they can respond to that. But I don't think we're really being honest unless we put that on the table.
Fox News said that Donald Trump's stop at the SU was a dangerous stop for him because of the flag issue, the SU. That was marked on national news.
Oh, really?
About us to be a dangerous stop for Donald Trump. I thought that was hilarious.
We're dangerous.
We're dangerous. Welcome with open arms. Hey, come to our university and use our student center. Yeah.
I don't know, I think it's about time that they talk about something other than his hands.
Jack, I did not hear that though, that they would tie those two together.
Yeah, my friends from Kansas sent me emails about the racism that was apparent.
Mm.
But there's a
There is another thing that the area is nationally known for, which I'm surprised it's me bringing this up, sports.
Yeah, that ought to be identified here. Winners.
Absolutely.
Title Town.
And it's an economic engine. DLPRA has the spreadsheets show that they bring in more tax dollars through all the softball and baseball tournaments than they collect.
Recreation, and that's a good point about Title Town. That absolutely needs to be in here. That was a special, you know, when you're competing against Green Bay and Chicago and you win, that's pretty awesome.
Work.
And a lot of that has to do with because we have awesome weather.
And it's also related to what you were bringing up, Jason, is know where do the races actually all get together? Sports.
Sports.
So.
Well, yeah, and we're getting those new soccer fields too. So we'll have a whole new little engine up in Ireland with the soccer fields.
It's going to be really nice.
It is.
I think those adult softball tournaments just pack out the hotels and motels.
Well, yeah, and the kids' travel teams do too.
Okay.
And they come with, you know, the whole team and all of their coaches and chaperones and the parents and, they load the places up.
Particularly when there's such a region of that between Georgia and Florida, it's one of the larger places, even another sports park up in Cecil, outside of Louds County, that they have an economic impact.
Yeah.
It's operating in the same impact too, but that's where we are.
Okay. We've started looking a little at cultural resources opportunities, but just to make sure, is everyone okay with moving ahead from
cultural resources issues onto opportunities? Let's take a look at those opportunities.
Carol, one thing that I feel like should be listed is I think we have more cultural opportunities because of the location of VSU here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I just feel like they kind of bring with the college some cultural opportunities.
They're sort of just blended in here with the symphony just on that one line. But you know, we do have plays in the Peach Summer
State
Summer
Theater.
Yeah.
Also.
We had a fellow contact the museum a few months ago. He wants to put together a book of walking tours in towns in Georgia, and he wants it to be the best and all that. And I told him we had some things already done that I could send him, some on the websites. But while I was talking with him, I had been chasing some other information and noticed where VSU, horticulture, biology, one of the ologies, okay, had gone and identified all the historic, every type of plant almost on campus and the historic ones. And we had so much in our archives about some historic plantings at VSU, and we got over to Dr. Emily Cantonwine, and she is actually having students, the oak where you enter the college on Patterson was planted by the first three graduates, and all these things just aren't known, you know. And they're this semester working up a VSU historic plantings, things that are named, and it kind of ties into, it's outdoor science in a sense, but it's history.
Mm-hmm.
But I know there's all kinds of, the band was asking for walking tours of towns, but I know, Patsy, there's old brochures in the archives from tourism when they used to be azalea blooming tours, these other tours, all kinds of drives are in town, and a lot of the work's already done if the azaleas haven't been poisoned or something. But there are many things that have that's already been done that just needs to be pulled out and get the dust off of them.
The city has a historic dragon tour brochure, which is nice, but so many portions of the city are really quite walkable. They're walking for a few years.
The driving tour one is the Heritage Foundation, the Conference Center pays for that
tour. The azalea tour, that's a good thing to lift back up. I mean, that
would
be a neat driving tour, like the canopy or the scenic route.
Yes. And even the little small tours within that, I mean, like a walking tour of the campus, walking tour downtown.
There's two
different ones. There's even an old walking tour of Sunset Hill Cemetery.
Yeah.
And there's one of the churches.
In the vials.
The
church is
that
one. Yeah. There's all kinds of work been done. It's just that
resources.
Yeah. It's just been very helpful. Well, speaking of the town, those Longreach on the north end of the campus of VSU, they're not only the oldest Longreach in the county, they're by far older than Valdosta. And there's probably still some oak trees around that are older than that. Those might be worth including on tour.
Well, and then the issues here, it says we lack a science museum, and yet VSU has one of the best herbariums.
That's what I thought.
You know, we have a really awesome herbarium, and no one...
No one knows.
I don't think I know about this. It's a
herbarium.
It's just marketing.
Yeah, it's marketing. It's just fabulous. And the students in there have been, you know, digitizing and cataloging. It's just awesome. We love plants at all.
Someone's probably comparing that to the one up in Cartersville, the Northwest Georgia Science Museum. I can't remember what the exact name for it's called. It's Booth.
Booth's Western, and he's
done
everything
else. Western. It was the one that replaced the Mineral Museum up there. It's like a much bigger science museum right off the interstate, I-75.
It's fairly new and modern.
Yeah. There's like an acronym for it, I don't remember, but I think that's probably what they're implying.
Yeah,
the science museum.
Well, it's just the science museum that was in Atlanta and got all the exhibits got trucked down here and rooms and storage?
No, it's a new one. They built a new one kind of between Atlanta and Chattanooga.
Yeah, it's Chattanooga. It's Northwest Storage.
Of course.
Northwest Storage.
Well, the booth, so the reason our historical museum opens is because of a person from Cartersville, Georgia. But he told us several years ago with Booth, he got into the cable business very, very early, and about 15, 12, 13 years ago, he sold his cable interest for $983 million. And that's why he's been able to open all these museums in Cartersville. That's where he was from. So, but anyway. That's where, if Cartersville wants it, if he wants Cartersville to have it, they're going to. So that's where he was from.
Are we still on cultural resources issues?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. She's an opportunity.
Are we to the opportunity? Yeah. Well, I noticed this about the programs for children. I would like to see more of them geared toward the environment and going on nature tours. All of it is football, sports, and making them more aware. I know we have Boy Scouts and all these other organizations, but on a large scale, it would be grand. The YMCA could have them put in at Cherry Creek or one of the other places and ride down to take back out at the YMCA. There are a lot of opportunities that haven't been explored for children to have a natural experience instead of, you know, all sports. It's hard to sell here, though, isn't it?
That science museum is called the TELUS.
Yes, science that's, museum. Yeah, that's it. The new start of the T is TELUS Museum.
I've heard of that.
It's a really nice facility.
All right, I know transportation isn't anywhere near as fun as cultural resources, but I suppose we should probably move on. Any last thoughts on the cultural resources?
I've got one under opportunities. There's a reference to Doc Holliday.
Yeah, there must be more to hear about.
Jingle bells.
CNS bank here.
Yep.
Well, so we've got a fun card we produced for when the state heritage tourism, first time they had that state meeting outside of Georgia, and the governor was choosing heritage tourism that ties in the Coca-Cola and the Pierpont and the peanuts and all that, which Gretchen, one day I'll get it to you and you can do something with it, because I know you will. But there is a fellow we were contacted, he's doing a book on the trail of Coca-Cola. He said what he's doing is everything but Atlanta. And because of websites, he found out about us to be in the second place in the world to bottle Coca-Cola and on and on. And we do have just enough that someone could look at. So we've been working up all early Coca-Cola images from here for him, and he's going to do a chapter on Valdosta in his book. He says there are people that are so into Coca-Cola, they'll get in their car. And
That's neat.
In the process. He's a man from Louisiana, but he's found the different areas, and Cartersville did have the first Coca-Cola sign, by the way.
And the one about encourage more museums or ways to incorporate the merging of the Old South and the Modern South, we're in the process of enlarging by moving into the Bird Hospital. The First Baptist Church no longer wanted it, so they wanted gave us a nice deal on that. So we'll have now, we're just so cramped the space, we can't do half of what we would like to, so some of this will play into being able to expand.
Sure. That probably should be listed as an opportunity, y'all's expansion. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Donald, while we're in here,
yeah,
I don't
you
want to
find some Brent money.
You need some people. We need human beings.
But Mr. Donald, while we have y'all both here, is there anything, sometimes people, you've heard a lot more about Civil War heritage type tourism. Is there any Civil War resources that we have as a local community?
We were included in Georgia's big Civil War brochures. The Civil War Committee, part of it was because of a collection we had that is very, very nice and special. But we were included as an example of a refugee town. And when Sherman, he actually wanted everyone to leave Atlanta, he about got them out of here, but just because the rail line, the one right back here, had just gotten here, you know, in 1860, this is where all these people came from. I mean, you hear the names Mackey and Holiday, that's why Doc Holiday was here, his father had refugees here. So we were on Civil War, the sesquicentennial commemoration, mainly because we were a large refugee center.
Okay.
People escaping. Sherman's watching. A lot of these people became our permanent citizens and helped build the town.
And we have
were they fleeing Savannah?
No, they were fleeing, basically fleeing Atlanta. And above that, the forces, the ones that gave the family that gave the first 30 acres for the cemetery, they were from the Rome area and were Unionist, but they got all hacked off when they found out that their place had been burned out. But they said that was everybody's excuse to us at the last minute, say we're Unionists. So who do you believe? The ones that really were, or the ones that weren't? But we have, and the Civil War here is also, Valdosta was only 4 months old. It had been chartered for 4 months when the Civil War started, maybe five. I'd have to check the dates. But so really, whatever about the Civil War, it's also the beginning of the town. They just absolutely coincide.
Well,
4 months?
December to April.
Okay. Well, actually, okay. No, it's not. Troopville predates that. And that in itself is a pretty amazing thing. How many places do you know where they picked up the whole town and moved it to the railroad?
They did that in everywhere. The first town that the railroad from Savannah went to was Thomasville. So every other county seat had to move to the railroad.
Well, that would be an interesting historical cultural thing to play up.
So. Yeah, well, especially because there's people who are just crazy about the railroads. I mean, they drive over to Folsom to watch the trains. Why couldn't we have a railroad history something?
That's right.
Well, no, we are not like Folkestone. But the area down by Olympic Park is a train watching area. It's a slight one.
Well, right, but I mean that people who are interested in trains would be interested in the history of the fact that when the railroad came, you know, all these houses
had to
move.
We've got a man started a. Georgia Southern and Florida, the rail line, are y'all near it? Fay Ira, the north-south one.
We can hear it from
we can
house.
Hear it, but it's not hear us.
I don't want to get, y'all can throw something at me, but a man from below Macon started a historic society, the Georgia Southern and Florida Railroad, and Harley Langdale was the last surviving, long time, the last survivor of their board. And but he started this historical society, and he all of a sudden, he looked 40, he was 52, and after 10 years, died. And we have been, because this museum and all paid attention to them and let them have one of their first conventions and workshops and all that here, we have been given a great portion of their materials. In our new building, we hope to have a... almost like a little exhibitor of its own of South Georgia Railroad history. Not necessarily South Georgia Railroad Museum, but a South Georgia Railroad History Museum, and basically try to cover everything below the 32nd parallel, which is the Atlantic and Gulf beginning in Savannah and bringing us our first rail. But we've got just vast amounts of information on South Georgia Railroad.
We're
very weak on some of the short lines, but that's...
Okay, so in last thing on cultural opportunities, we have a rich history, and we should promote it.
If I could, since you brought up the Civil War, I remember at the sesquicentennial celebration down at the courthouse, John Robinson had the best costume, I thought. He came in slave dress. If you're going to talk about the Civil War, you have to talk about all of it.
Yeah.
Well, there are even writings about how the fellow from the Barry Jones plantation was and got his name, but how he was the one in town that made everybody's shoes. He was a craftsman that was a slave. He was an artisan. Mm-hmm. And so there's stories do still exist and survive. Mm-hmm.
The railroad discussion provides a nice segue into the transportation. So let's take a look at the transportation issues.
And Nathan, just so you know, I know it's your first meeting, but these are not final comments. Ariel will continue to put out drafts. Don't feel like, you know, feel like if you miss something, you can always go back and add in. It's not like we closed the chapter on this. We're not going to talk about it. So the document's continually open for discussion.
Yeah. The door doesn't close for a long time.
Since you bring up transportation and rail, have you ever heard of the doodle buggy?
Yes.
Somebody's heard of it. Mm-hmm. Of course. Went from Quitman to Adel. It was a one car trip, rail, car, and engine. It was a popular thing. I just discovered recently. Does everybody know where Blue Spring is?
Yes.
But just south of USA, over just on the Brooks County side. That used to be a big resort and built next to the railroad. And then I believe it was 1908, a fellow in Putnam had in mind to build an electric railroad to Valdosta and Thomasville. I haven't been able to dig up whether he actually built it. But we do, of course, know that Valdosta was the smallest city to have an electric railroad system in the city.
Yeah, come to the museum and you can find out more about all that.
Yeah, it's been.
They used to have a rail line between Quitman and Valdosta in the last 50 years.
That's right.
Yeah. Passenger rail.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, well, up until the 60s, there was still halfway decent passenger rail.
Well, all tracks exist in every direction. If somebody wanted to put the effort into it, it would be possible to do a commuter rail.
Ariel, somehow I know there's transit comments in here. The truth about transit is we have a rural transit provider that is probably less than marketed, but we still do, you know, 30,000 plus trips a year. Mm-hmm. What I think people refer to, though, is they're interested in a fixed route urban transit system.
Yes, and we should, I'll make sure that that's made clear, that that's clarified.
So we can have a rural.
That exists now.
That's right. The rural transit, you know, it's not on demand, but you can call them a day ahead of time and schedule a ride. But there are conversations about expanding that into an urban fixed route system. And the issue is cost. It's easy to tell someone that people will use a transit system. It is hard to talk about how you pay for that. So I think that maybe that should be, you know, I don't know how you separate those, but to me the issue with an urban fixed route transit system is the cost.
Yeah, I'll make sure to make that clear.
And
yeah.
The costs are twofold. It's startup costs and also
maintenance.
Building costs. Yeah. So startup wasn't such a problem, it was ongoing.
That night, it's not hard for us to convince people that and leadership that people will use it. It's just hard to convince, is it worth the cost to do it?
I came across the overpass on the way from 75. How much did that cost?
$7.
Is that ever going to
pay
back?
Per taxpayer around the United States.
Yeah.
Yeah, better question. Who paid for it?
Yeah.
Yeah, who paid for it?
Well,
state and federal.
Yeah. Indeed. And there was federal money available for rail, but our state decided to turn it down. It's a matter of what do you want to do?
Yeah, I agree.
Also, while having observed bus systems start in places like Austin, Texas, actually, we have to keep promoting it, get people to ride it.
Sure, I think marketing is an issue for the existing rural transit system, but I think people are surprised when you mention, you know, we're at 30 plus thousand trips. They're like, oh, mm-hmm. But I don't think a lot of people know about it. You're right. Marketing is an issue.
It's underutilized.
And I think that that number will change now that they've cut the city off. So the rural part of it, people in the rural part actually weren't getting 30,000 rides.
Right. It wasn't just rural areas. They were providing urban trips as well because they were trying to serve a need.
Right.
So it doesn't provide urban trips?
It does currently, but I think they've set a deadline that
it has to be phased out due to funding sources.
Yeah. And there's been that pilot project with the NPO.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The urban transit, which is a lot more successful than the thought it would. And then gathering the user data and so forth. Interesting to see that question.
How it goes. And I think it should be pointed out that MIDS is a private company, and just because when they phase out these urban trips, doesn't mean MIDS can't provide them. It just means they can't use that funding source.
Right, it'll cost more for the people who are using the urban portion of it.
I don't want people to think that all of a sudden those trips completely cease. I think they'll be provided. It just probably might be more expensive.
In transportation, I've noticed that it doesn't say, we don't have enough sidewalks. You might say that our town wants to have a walking tour, but you're going to be walking on the dink on Main Street or in the river on Tube Street. So we need more sidewalks.
Yeah, the last item on that page can be extended to
that's good. It's sort of like blended into the bottom. Oh, no, by the way, we need more sidewalks.
I'll make sure it fits that explicitly. Yeah.
Yep.
That's very important.
The truck traffic downtown needs to go away. Who wants to sit out and eat their dinner outside or their lunch and have a truck?
Whacked by a log off the back of the truck? Yeah.
You know, little bits of wood flying off or whatever. I mean, it's not just the log trucks. All trucks go on that route. Mm-hmm.
They've tried to get them to utilize the van.
I know, so we'll keep trying. Put it in here.
What's the history on that? Wasn't there a rerouted for a while?
Well, they built the overpass.
Okay, so it was rerouted until the overpass opened, and now it's all right.
Yeah. It was a temporary reroute.
Yeah, sort of. And they couldn't get
that. That was so nice. I forgot about it.
Yeah.
US 221 and 41, they're required to use the perimeter route. Yeah, I think the only highway now is 84,
mm-hmm.
which an alternative route has not been prepared because you cannot be but a certain amount of percentage of miles, is it?
There's some constraints that the state will say, sure, we will do a bypass route if it is so close and it doesn't cost truck drivers X amount of time.
Yeah.
And so far, those constraints, they have not been met, especially with the new overpass. That does not help because it's faster to get through downtown now. So the overpass, exacerbated.
And you get Corey and JD on this too. But you mentioned the NPO study for bypass and truck traffic, which is ongoing.
Can the city do anything about that?
Well, there's an NPO thing that's going on, and the city would like to do it. It's just coming up with a route that actually works well.
What's the NPO?
There's some different ideas of balanced around organization.
Yeah, they're having a study done, actually. I think it's a $100,000 study.
Yep.
And the consultant's already been on the ground. He's already interviewed several city staff, myself included.
County's one.
A few weeks ago. County, did he come to you guys? Mm-hmm.
Good. Jack, the NPO is, when we got metropolitan status, mm-hmm. one of the things that came along with that was the federal government saying, you will have a transportation plan. So when you hear about Corey, that's Corey. And so part of the things he's looked at and they've tried to implement with the city, and in some cases the county, have been, okay, state, what can we do about this issue? And so far they've tried maybe three or so serious attempts, and it just has not been successful.
We just had them routed around the city before the overpass was open.
That's right.
So we know how to do something about it, but we have to implement them. $100,000 study to do what we've already done.
Because the state has rules that says that detour couldn't be the permanent route because
city,
it's too long.
Right, and the city requested that temporary detour be made permanent.
So the study's aim is get outside perspective to see if there is literally either changing an existing route or building a new route. Is it worth alleviating that issue?
Or some combination thereof.
That's right. yeah, and I we'll see. When you say 100,000, there was debate about whether or not it was worth it, but the local match was around 10 or 20% of that. It was largely federally funded, which I think helped. If it was completely locally funded, I don't know if it would be pursued.
And went through on the MPO.
I know I should know the answer to this, but where was it rerouted? Interferential?
Gil Harbin. Gil Harbin,
St. Augustine.
Yeah.
St. Augustine down to Gil Harbin. Did you say Gil?
No.
Not the Clay Road.
No.
Yeah, Clay was
connected. No, just the ones at 84 around to Gil Harbin.
Mm-hmm.
And then up to St. Augustine and then back to 84. Just came.
Are you going east or west? I was going east.
I was going west. If you were coming from 75, you would have turned to the right on St. Augustine,
yep,
and gone around and then turned left on Harbin, and then come around to Perimeter. Or really,
you didn't go to Perimeter.
Yeah, no, it was on the
Stateville. Up to the New Stateville. And either went all the way down to Clay or Turkow Road.
No, it went on the Madison Highway.
That's right.
And it's not, but it's not fast enough for the state to have awarded their permanent status. Was the
just a lot of curves.
Yeah.
I'm happy for trucks.
Yeah. So they.
That's right. And part of the issue, too, Jack, I mean, when that Oak Pass has been built, Hill Avenue was never completely shut down, except for a couple of times when the cranes were doing certain things. And a lot of trucks were still trying to squeeze through there. All the locals knew that it was still open, but all the cars were going that way. Trucks started falling. Always some trucks. Some trucks were finding other routes, like Savannah Avenue and River Street.
Oh, yeah, I saw a lot of trucks on River Street.
I do too.
I don't know where that
Walmart trucks, particularly.
But this may or may not be related, but it's certainly concerning to me the second to last building for opportunities. Mm-hmm. When you say outer perimeter, where are we talking about?
It's not on, I've not seen on the books anywhere, John, where it shows a route. Just the concept.
It comes from the 90s.
Scratch it off.
Outer perimeter was not ever intended to be a new road. It was to upgrade existing roads that were dirt roads.
That's right.
To pave them and connect them together so there would be sort of a haphazard path that was paved.
So we
and
that
county completed
we
that a long
that.
Time ago, like 15 years ago. It had a reference to it needs to go away.
Well, I'll tell you why I'm concerned. There's a de facto outer perimeter, which is 122 Maverick Road, Cat Creek Road, radar site to Moody.
That's correct.
You can shake your head all you want.
You should see the trucks that go down that road. Big, like, carrying gasoline trucks. They're like, okay, these trucks do not belong on these roads, but they're using it.
I shake my head because mine.
They're going from Moody to Hanover.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's the route from the interstate into Moody.
That's correct.
Shortcut.
And it's not much of a shortcut. 122 is less than 1 mile north of Cat Creek Road. Mm-hmm. If you know, we're talking about routing truck traffic around downtown Valdosta, how about we put local traffic only on Hamburg Road on each way?
Yeah, that road didn't get so that it has to be repaved because the people that live there are driving on it. It got that way because trucks drive on it.
That's the first I've heard of it, y'all. And I shake my head about outer perimeter because to me the outer perimeter concept that I'm aware of didn't go that far north.
Well, and the thing is, where the base is located, and now the entrance of the base on Davidson, you know, it's not people aren't going to come downwards. If they're going to want to go to the north at all, they cut through our neighborhood.
You mean on Hamburg?
Yeah.
That's interesting. Why would I get off 122 to cut over on Hamburg?
Because it's shorter. And you don't have to go to the death corner of Walker's Crossing.
So maybe you tell me that I plug it into Google Maps and I say, give me the shortest route, and that's what
should happen. Oh, yeah.
And this is bringing up if you go 122 Walker's Crossing and then down Bemis Road, Walker's Crossing has no actual traffic. We do have a blinker these days, and it just does watch out.
Just says cross traffic does not stop.
Yes, yeah, says cross traffic does not stop. That's correct,
it really
and it doesn't stop.
Yes. I'm wondering if good big road that goes from Valdosta commuting to Nashville, Georgia.
Yeah.
And you have, you know, Lakeland traffic as well. When I take higher.
Yeah.
It really should be a traffic light there.
Yeah.
I almost got in a wreck there.
People get in a wreck there all the time.
It used to be the other way to stop. 122 didn't stop. And they switched it. Because my granddad about killed himself, not realizing that.
They changed it.
Well,
they changed
it. For a while, it did have a flashing light at least, you know, above the road, but then they took all those down on 122. There used to be a flashing light at Skipper Bridge or Valdo. And they took all those flashing overhead lights down and just had the ones that are at the side of the road that says cross traffic doesn't stop.
Yeah, just on the stop sign.
Yeah.
Wonderful way for language, and since Moody has a new community planner that's on board, is maybe to coordinate with Moody with their preferred route to I-75, particularly with regard to their truck vendors.
Very good.
Matt, have you met Derek yet?
And so, by the way, it's not just trucks either, it's people that work on
this.
It's the workers, too. They're driving. They live in Hiawatha, and they're driving to work. They work on the base.
Moody is a city. They're their own city, so treating them like a city is appropriate for traffic influx.
I mean, obviously, the regular traffic with the trucks.
Yeah, that's the first I've heard about that.
We get supplies by rail, but that's long gone.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I heard about. I never thought about how the trucks get there.
And it's like 1 mile up Nemus Road to 122 from Moody. The issue about Walker's Crossing is they're both state roads. So if the county and Moody, you know, in concert ask the state to do something about it, maybe something could be done about it.
I'm just telling you, maybe Mike knows. It's the first I've heard of that.
He knows.
He knows.
Okay.
He maybe didn't tell you.
Mm-hmm. That's okay.
Under opportunities, we have Highway 84 widening will provide a better route to Savannah. How does that pertain to Lowndes County, like solely Lowndes County? It's the only place that I can think of that it pertains to is between Norville and Baycross.
Some of this has been on here evidently a long time.
Yeah. Should that belong on a county document where it's already four lane the entire route?
Right. Well, they're four laning it in that place you're talking about.
Yes, that is true.
I think that has
again, it's not Lowndes County.
It has to do with the fact that when it's four lane to all the way, that increases our chance of becoming an inland port. Without that, with that bit still being narrow, we can't be an inland port.
Yeah,
it improves our connection to the coast. But maybe the opportunity should stick that and
should that be reasonable?
Yes.
Well, it's being built. I mean, it's a done deal, man.
It's just not
done. Just drive that way, and I mean,
oh, yeah, they're working on it.
Yeah.
We may not want to need to put it on there, so we'll complete it. I mean, there's also the four lane, 133, Port Ultra, which is also starting in the first count.
More thoughts on transportation issues, opportunities?
Did it say anything about pedestrian safety? I know there's like some crossing signals out by the mall in Matrix that don't work so well.
Under issues for transportation, the last item starts pedestrian crossing, particularly around.
Oh, I see.
Particularly around needs to be expanded.
Yeah.
Well, and I think that we're not addressing enough the fact that we don't have bike lanes. I mean, if you wanted to ride your bike, it's not safe. I'm one time tried to ride my bike to town. I'm like, okay, that was enough.
It's not worth dying
for. It's just, it's not safe to ride your bike to town. And so it's not just, you know, driver education and bicycle education, you know, it's, we need bike lanes if people can ride their bikes.
It's not just paying stripes either. People don't respect the stripes. There has to be a physical barrier to protect people who are on bicycles. Hence, the poor fellow who was mistaken for a dog and not a truck.
Well, yeah, that's happened more than once that somebody's been hit and they said, I thought I hit a deer. Just kept going.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
And speaking of bicycles, how about a bike share service?
Mm-hmm.
Opportunity.
They just restriped the bike lanes on Sestella Avenue. It would be interesting to know if that's really improved things because they were pretty much faded away.
If I remember right, isn't it true there isn't any transportation project or roads that involve DOT funding that we have to consider the multimodal aspect of it?
I think so.
Just like why Woodrow Wilson has bike lanes because the state was involved in
that. It doesn't say you will, but it just says you have to consider.
Well, and I don't know where the...
But it did not used to say that.
I don't know. Is it a state law that you can't ride your bicycle on the sidewalk? Is that a state law?
There is a state law that you can't. Yeah. Of course, it's violated all the time.
Right. Well, so maybe we should get the state law changed.